Well, I am always excited about Soap Sunday. Do you want to know why? Because I believe in body ministry. I believe that God speaks to every one of us in the body of Christ. He has things that he wants to speak to us. He wants to develop an intimacy with us. And I just love hearing what God is saying to other people. And so, you know, soaping is just a tool. There's many tools that you can use, but it is a great tool to learn to hear God speak to you through his word. And it's about developing intimacy with God, the author of the book. And see, this is the most amazing, most pertinent, most relevant book in existence. Now, I realize it's 66 books that have been put together, but it is the most amazing book. Talk about an ability to speak into the very situations, the very things that I'm walking through in my life. And see, when you believe that about the Bible, you stop letting it collect dust. And you think, wow, I've got to let God speak to me today. And you say, Holy Spirit, teach me. Holy Spirit, teach me. The Holy Spirit wants to teach you. He wants to mentor you and guide you into all truth. And see, the thing about the Holy Spirit that I've discovered is that he doesn't force himself on anybody. You have to activate him. How do you activate him? Just by acknowledging his presence. He is the helper. He is the paraclete. But I've discovered I need to ask for his help. And when I read my Bible, if I'll say, Father, thank you for your word. Holy Spirit, would you open my eyes to see and to hear what you want to say to me today, that an amazing thing begins to happen. When you read your Bible, not just to get smarter, when you read your Bible to be transformed and changed, it comes alive. It is a living word. Who would like to begin today? Who would like to come and share a soap today? I feel like I need to clear up the pile of papers I have here so there's even room for somebody to come and share. Hey, Jan, come on.
I'll be your icebreaker.
Be the icebreaker.
Thank you. Good morning. Yeah. My scripture is Mark 12, starting with verses 29 to 31. For anybody that's been walking with me, I've been challenged back when Dan Moeller came about becoming love. And that keeps coming back and coming back. Actually, I'm supposed to be writing a book, and you guys have permission to go, how's that book coming? You need to drive me on. It was originally about covenant, but now recently he says it's got to be covenant based on intimacy. Mm-hmm. And so this scripture is out of the expanded version. If you go to Bible Gateway, it's probably the only place I've ever seen this. Jesus answered, the most important command is this. Listen, people of Israel, or hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is the only God, or the one God. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. And actually, this is the Shema, the people that are pious Jews say that twice a day. And the second command is this. Love your neighbor as you love yourself. There are no commands more important or greater than these. So, as a Christian, it's been a Christian a long time, sometimes you go through a scripture you know really well, and you stop for a minute, and you're going, well, that's everything. And God said that was the most important. Everything else is of lesser value than loving the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, with all your mind. Love your neighbor as yourself. And I keep going, how do you do that? I know if I hold my life up against that standard, I fall painfully short, and you could come under condemnation, but Jesus doesn't do that to you. Amen. What you do is you call out, Lord, have mercy on me. I'm not doing this very well. When I started this process with the Lord, first thing he does is he goes in and he puts his finger on the hate that you've got in your heart. And I found out what a wicked hater I am. And he's been doing a process of taking the hate out, taking the resentment out, taking the bitterness and everything, the bad thoughts. So what does love look like? The observation was, I really need God's mercy to do this, and all of us do. And so it's okay to cry out, Lord, have mercy on me. I need the help to learn to love. What does it look like application? It can be as simple as being in the store and smiling at somebody. It can be taking time to listen to what a person is going through today. This week, love looked like my coworker finding out that her daughter has cancer. And I don't believe God gave me cancer, but I had the same experience that she is going through right now. And so I said to her, okay, I want to walk with you with this. I want to walk with you as a parent. I want to walk with your daughter. I offered to her, call me. You know, same kind of cancer of all things. You're going to the same kind of hospitals. What does love look like? I don't have answers for her. I'm willing to pray for her. I'm willing to walk with her, but that's what love looks like. And that just kind of welled up in me. I had that experience. God gives me grace to help somebody else with that. What does love look like? There was this whole bunch of witches putting curses on President Trump. Well, you could get in a let's go after him, or you can look at it and say, Jesus, have mercy on them. They are horribly deceived. And I ask that you turn us around and cancel the curses, yes, but in Jesus' name, I ask you to go after those witches, and I ask that you cause them to be born again. Shine your light at them. Shine your light in their heart. They're horribly deceived. Have mercy on them. I ask that you save them in Jesus' name. We have a lot of Christians dying at the hands of ISIS. You could curse them. Yeah, that would be a natural way of going at it. Or you can say, Lord, have mercy on them. They are horribly deceived. I ask that you send your light into their heart. I ask that you go after them by your spirit. And I ask that you save ISIS fighters. And there are some getting saved now. There are some turning to Christ for that. So what does love look like? Do the opposite of what a human being would do. Sometimes your first reaction is, and back up and operate out of an opposite spirit, a loving spirit. You have to have Holy Spirit help you with this. So here's my prayer. Lord, I lay down my whole being and every detail of my life as a living sacrifice, based on Romans 12. You are worth it all. You are worth it all. I ask you to ever increase in my heart and my mind and my life your love for you and love for people. Love people through me in Jesus' name. Amen.
Wow. Let me become love. Wow. Who's next? David, come on. How you doing, my brother?
Morning. Yeah, the scripture I chose this morning was found in 1 Thessalonians 1:8-10. I've kind of favored Paul's epistles. He wrote 13 or 14, depends if you think Hebrews was written by Paul or not. So, but I've been reading the epistles in the order that Paul wrote them. So in 49 AD, he wrote Thessalonians. So that's almost, 1968 years ago. So anyway, 1 Thessalonians, for from you, the word of the Lord was sounded forth not only in Macedonia and Achaia, but also in every place. Your faith toward God has gone out, so that we do not need to say anything. For they themselves declare concerning us what manner of entry we had to you, and how you turned to God from idols to serve the living and true God, and to wait for his Son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, even Jesus, who delivers us from the wrath to come. My observation here is that we're still waiting. That was 49 AD, and this is 2017. So we're still waiting for Jesus today. But God raised Jesus from the dead, and this is important because we are in Christ, and Christ is seated at the right hand of God in heaven, just as we are. So how does Jesus deliver us? Well, there's some other scriptures that talked about deliverance. Back in Exodus, it talked about In fact, I'll read that. Exodus 12:12. For I will pass through the land of Egypt this night, and I will smite all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, both man and beast, against all the gods of Egypt, and I will execute judgment. I am the Lord, and the blood shall be to you for a token upon the houses where you are. And when I see the blood, I will pass over you, and the plague shall not be upon you to destroy you when I smite the land of Egypt and Israel out of land of Egypt. Okay. So then there are some other, of course, they were delivered out of Egypt. And also, it's interesting, too, that when Israel was delivered, they crossed the Red Sea. They didn't cross the Green Sea or the Blue Sea or the Dead Sea. They crossed the Red Sea. And I think the Red Sea is probably significant in that it probably just is a type of blood. You know, it indicates it crossing of the blood. So, so how does he deliver us today? Well, Ephesians 1:7 says we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace. So we're delivered by his blood and also his grace. And Ephesians 2:8 says, for by grace you have been saved through faith, and not of yourselves, a gift, not of works, lest anyone should boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. So it's his grace, it's his blood, and it's our faith that he's given us. And the gospel says in 1 Corinthians 15, 1-4, moreover, brethren, I declare to you the gospel which I preached to you, which you also receive, in which you stand, by which you are saved, if you hold fast the word which I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. For I delivered to you, first of all, that which I also received, that Christ died for our sins, according to the scriptures, and he was buried and rose again on the third day. So my application is just to remember that I am delivered from the wrath to come by God's gift of grace, and that came through the blood of Jesus. My deliverance from the wrath to come was not free to God or to his son, Jesus Christ. And my prayer is, dear Heavenly Father, thank you that you have loved me so much. You willingly gave your begotten son to take my place and deliver me from the wrath to come. Thank you for restoring my relationship with you, just like Adam and Eve before the fall in the Garden of Eden. Thank you that I will be spending eternity with you. I pray that my children and my grandchildren will come to you, saving knowledge of your gift of grace. You are a truly awesome God.
Good stuff. How many know that'll preach? Amen. Who's next? Michelle. Isn't it great to hear what God is stirring in the body of Christ's heart?
Thank you. I love hearing it. It's awesome. I brought my pen up here so I could hold my place, and then I took my pen out. So just like I had to get a bigger book so I didn't have to turn my pages as much when I was writing. Okay. So this soap I titled My Weakness is My Strength. And this is from 2 Corinthians 12:9-10, and it's actually through the Amplified Version. So verse 9 starts by saying, but he has said to me, my grace is sufficient for you. My loving kindness and my mercy are more than enough, always available regardless of the situation. For my power is being perfected and is completed and shows itself most effectively in your weaknesses. Therefore, I will all the more gladly boast in my weaknesses so that the power of Christ may completely enfold me and dwell in me. Verse 10 says, so I am well pleased with the weaknesses, with insults, with distress, with persecutions, and with difficulties for the sake of Christ. For when I am weak in my own human strength and abilities, then I am strong, truly able, truly powerful, truly drawing from God's strength. I almost gave its own observation, but the grace and mercy really, really stood out to me, so I looked those up, and grace is the free and unmerited favor of God as manifested in the salvation of sinners and the bestowal of blessings, and mercy is compassion or forgiveness shown towards someone who it is within one's power to punish or harm. God freely gives us that mercy. So I kind of just reworded those couple sections just to really, really put it I guess in my own words for myself, but he said that my grace is sufficient for you, meaning my free and unmerited favor is enough for you, for me. His compassion and forgiveness are more than enough and always available to me, because his power in my life is most effective, most valuable, and is completed in my weakness. God's grace and mercy are enough to cover me and fill in the gaps of my life as I let go of the perfection mentality. His compassion and forgiveness cover all things in my life and are always available if I will just receive them in that weakness. It's in my weakness and imperfections, weakness of imperfections, that he is raised up in power to show his mightiness in my life through his grace and mercies. Because when I stop trying to be all the things in my own strength, I give him access and an invitation to actually be all things, to be my strength, knowing that my limitations to be perfect are the exact perfect moments for him to show his strength and perfection in my life. And he is well pleased with my weakness, in my difficulties, because it gives him the ability to fulfill his desire in my life by being my strength and power that I need. Without those moments, I live in a state of pride, feeling as though I am the perfect one, creating a perfect life with no need for my creator. Pride in any area of my life will lead to a fall and leave a trail of hurt, pain, and destruction behind and before me. We were not created to live life in our own human strength, apart from the leading, guiding, and prompting of our one and only true love, our creator. So my application was to be okay with my imperfections, my limitations, because in those okay moments, it allows God to not only work on my behalf, but it allows him to shine in all the glory that he deserves. And it gives me freedom to live in a state of self-forgiveness for my imperfections, which gives me more compassion and forgiveness for other people's faults and imperfections and limitations in their lives. So my prayer was, oh Lord, you are so amazing every day and in every way. You continue to amaze me by your greatness and your power. But even more, I'm amazed at your vastness of love for me. Just me, as one person in this world. Your love for me propels me and fires me to live in a life worthy of your calling and your desires. The greatness of love that you have for each person on this earth, to desire to give them each the freedom to live in an acceptance of imperfections, knowing that you are perfect and you will give us all that we need to live our lives for you and show your love to the world solely through our weaknesses and even through our worldly difficulties. So Lord, help me continue to embrace all that you are speaking to me only so I can be a light for you, sharing and showing your greatness with those around me in every and all situation, in all areas that I walk through in my life. Let my imperfections reflect the brilliance of your beautiful light in my life radiating through me. Let my life be a walking testimony of your love, your mercy, and your grace, regardless of the sacrifice of my flesh and my feelings and my emotions. Let my life reflect your love in a way that draws others closer to you. In Jesus' name.
Awesome. How many would like to have Lachelle call you on Tuesday morning and share that with you again? Amen. Good stuff. Wow, I love it. Who else would like to share? Hi, Karen. Oh, you're next though.
I got a
And this is going to be an object lesson, huh?
I don't want to lose any places here. It sounds like we've been talking a lot about love. And I'll tell you, I've been reading Mark over and over and over, and I thought, Lord, I agree with everything. You know, what else is there to say? Let's just read the book of Mark. But I have a lot of fondness about Mark, because when I was about 9 years old, the Lord... Well, I was going to a Presbyterian church, and they said, you can be a member in the church. And at not 4 years old, I said, that's fourth grade or nine. I guess those are about the same. And at that time, I was going through a lot of things, and my parents are both alcoholics, and they're no longer with us, but they are with the Lord. because I was able to lead them to the Lord, and so I'm excited about that. But when I came to, the pastor suggested to me, I felt very personal, and all the other fourth graders, that you can read the book of Mark, because in the book of Mark, it's all about Jesus, and it's very short. And so I went home that day, and I went and I read the book of Mark. And in the first chapter, these words jumped out at me. It said, "Then Jesus said to them," his disciples, "Follow me, and I will make you fishers of men." Well, I thought immediately, I'm going to be a missionary. And I look back at that and I think, my goodness, I had such perception to receive a word that was spiritual. But I was physical. And I've thought about that. I didn't remember that until I was baptized in the Holy Spirit. It's amazing what the Holy Spirit can bring back to you when you get out of religion and into the Word. And I must say, I marvel, Pastor, at you, because you give your pulpit up and you don't know a thing of what we're going to say. And yet, I think he knows he can take care of it. But I've never seen that in any other church. And, you know, I do missionary work. I've been to 17 nations, and some of them more than once. And I'm kind of taking a break this year and trying to decide what I'm to do. But I think when I was going through Mark, the Lord spoke to me right here during praise and worship. And because I was nervous, and he says, "You're anointed, I'm with you, you speak my words." And I'm thinking, okay. And what, I got stuck on Mark 8. And I thought over it over and over, because what Jesus is doing is he's instructing his disciples. All along you see, you know, and here it is, right in the beginning of Mark chapter 8. "I have compassion on," this is when the multitude came, and he really had a lot of compassion on them. And he says, "Because they have now continued with me 3 days and have nothing to eat." And so I thought about that. I thought, what he did, I can imagine in my mind what he did. We're talking about are hearing from God. And we're also talking about the fact that he's with us and shows us what to do. What God showed Jesus what to do, because he was looking on the multitude, and I believe he was seeing the people that were coming out of Egypt and how they received the manna. Because when I came to myself, actually, I had gone to Dr. T.L. Osborne's funeral, what they called Celebrating Life. They talked about his conscious presence of Jesus everywhere he goes. And I heard that so many people was giving a testimony. I left without a revelation of that. And so when I was looking at this, further down into Mark, I got to go back. "I've told you before that I have seen marvelous miracles while I was working as a nurse in a clinic. And when the reason what happened was as a nurse, you can get really bitter and cynical, because these people come in and they want more pain medication. And, you know, there's nothing subjective that they can see. But the doctor, you know, and he wants to help him too. Well, at this one time, this girl came in and she was bawling, she was crying, she was, because I'm just typing away, getting her name in on the computer, thinking of nothing. And then all of a sudden I'm looking at her and she's just bawling. I mean, she's just spent. And I said, "What? Why are you here?" And then she just starts telling me, I have fibromyalgia, whatever. And it won't come out of that mouth, you know. And anyway, the thought came to me. You see, one of the values of reading the Gospels is because we have a lot of examples. And so I had this thought, and the thought was, Jesus is here. and he wants to heal her. I didn't really have a one. On the other ones, I had stories, and I had, you know, little glimpses of what Jesus did. But here, I said, can I, you know, I believe that Jesus is here with us right now, because that's what he's telling me. And I said, he wants to heal you. Can I pray for you? And he said, she said, yes. And all of a sudden, she just started perking up. She just started to have some expectation. She started thinking, oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. And I said, can I lay hands on you? And she said, oh, yeah, right now, right now. And I was just, and I compassion was still all over me. And I just put my hand on her and out the door, because my computer was already set up, and so I didn't have to stay any longer, so I knew he was coming, and so the doctor, and I had to get out of there. So when I got out of there, she was doing pretty good, but I didn't know anything. I was seeing people, I can't tell you how many, maybe 100 people a day, and they're coming in, and we gotta get them out. So I never remembered, but she came back a month later, and she's going like this to her mother, like this, and pointing at me, and I'm thinking, what's up with her? I don't even remember praying for her. And so she came, as she's walking by me, she says, I'm all healed. And I said, praise the Lord. And I said, that's Jesus. Now you always have to, I'm giving you some instruction here. In Mark, I think it's in Mark, yes it is, after John the Baptist dies, or they kill him. And they said to him, Jesus said, as you go doing, then, he said, bring the kingdom of God here. Yeah, and that's what I heard again with Pastor Stewart. Is that his name, Stewart? And he was telling us that that's exactly what we have to do. We bring the kingdom. And see, if Jesus is alive and he's with us, we have to let them know that. And so when we let them know that, then they get into the kingdom with me, and we can pray and see results. And so just as we were praying today, I said, can I put my hand in your ears? Oh, yes. And so I'm praise the Lord. You know, it was Jesus. You know, all we have to say in Jesus' name, be healed. But sometimes we feel like we have to do more. But really, that's all we need to say. And so that was one. So anyway, we have another part. Okay, so they feed the 4,000, and then the 4,000 are going on their way, and then Jesus wants to take them across to Caesarea Philippi, I believe. Or was that, anyway, where's, oh, here it is. And I want to show you this picture, because I went to Israel, and this is Caesarea Philippi. And what it is this is a big rock surface. And this rock surface has all these different kings and important people, gods, mostly gods, and then Jesus is right here, and he says, oh, I'm sorry, he says, who do you think I am? And he's speaking to his disciples, and then the disciple, he says, you are the Christ, Peter said, you are the Christ. And that's all he said. And that's what I stumbled on for a long time until I found out what Jesus really wanted me to say. Because I thought, well, what's the big deal about that? But he says, so what he said, what I want to show you here, is here's where all the kings and all the Caesars and all those people were engraved in there. And there was other places along the side where other people were. It's beautiful, really. It's when you think about this area, it's really looks lush, and it was really nice being there because we just love it. But we kept walking around saying, Jesus is the Christ. Jesus is the Son of God. And so what he was doing, I'm talking too long, I think, but just go like this. Okay, wind it up. Okay, so then this is the gates of hell. This big dark place is the gates of hell, and you could throw stuff down it and you couldn't hear the bottom. So when Peter said it in John, he says, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. So I stumbled over the two people saying what Peter said, thou art the Christ, and what Peter said in John, thou art the Christ, the Son of God. But then the Lord showed me that, hey, different authors, different audiences. So don't get hung up on it. And I think that's pretty much what I wanted to say, except on our... Okay. So when I was praying for these people in the clinic, each one had a... There was nine people that I prayed for. They all got healed. And it was like one after the other, but not the same day. But the Lord always gave me a vision. So there was a patient who came in, and he's going like this, and holding his head, and he's Hispanic. I wish I never took drugs. I never wish I never took drugs. And then the thought came to me, you can have the mind of Christ. And so I said, do you know that Jesus can give you the mind of Christ? He can? And so I said, yes. Have you received Jesus? What do you mean? And so I said, well, receive Jesus. He died for you. He took your sin, and he can heal you. And I gave him those, and so I prayed. He came back a month later, and he was, you've seen him. He looked like he had a job the other time. He looked like he was homeless. One other fantastic one, and there were others, but this one lady came in, and she had to have a physical before she went to rehab. And so I went to, I said, do you need prayer for anything? And she said, yes, my son, I got him on drugs, and I don't know where he is. I haven't heard from him for over a year. And the thought came to me, he can come to his senses. I mean, these are all scriptural things that the Lord has shown me, and I tell him that, and I said, we're going to pray for him. He's going to contact you, and so you'll know. Anyway, so we prayed, and she was at peace. And then about a month later, after she was out of rehab, she said, my son called me that night. I mean, these are miracles, and these are just amazing. So what I want to say, I was going to tell you about the different kinds of knowledge. One is spiritual. The other is flesh and blood and senses. And people that are unbelievers, they don't know that they're just sense-driven. And they need God so that they can be restored, that they can know Jesus Christ and his love. You know, Jesus is coming back real soon. And I've been grieving over the fact that God's going to see these people go to hell. And I believe I'm hearing the heart of God, and there's such a desire in me to really get people out of hell. Not physically, but before they die, before he comes. And so we need to just really pray, and I'm just praying and asking the Lord to really show me what I can do for the kingdom. I'm sorry this has really been muttered, but you know, I don't know how to put things in paper. I think I need to practice more. But I just want to, let's just pray. Father, we just thank you for your son, Jesus Christ, and your word, and the fact that you give us the knowledge that we need. Father, we have children that need to know you, and we thank you that you give us the words to speak. You give us the open door. You lead people across their path so that they can receive Jesus Christ, and all families will be reunited for eternity. In Jesus' name, amen.
And thank you, Karen. Ione.
Thank you. Thank you for identifying that theme of love, because I also picked up on that. I feel like that's my favorite part about Soap Sunday, is that you could see what other people are listening to, and it's usually a theme that all of us get. I love that. So it's so funny. I texted Pastor Dave, can I use a whole, you know, chapter for my scripture? And before he could even answer me, the Lord was like, no, cannot do that.
I love it when God covers for me.
Yeah. As soon as I sent it, he was like, you need to wrap it up, you know, better. I was so excited. So my scripture is 1 John 4:19. we love because he first loved us. And I will be referencing 1 John 4, 7, 9 through 11, 16, 18, and 19. My observation. While I was reading 1 John 4, the Holy Spirit took my breath away, and I felt as if I was ascending toward my Heavenly Father up in heaven. I could smell the serene fragrance of his presence, and all I can say is that his aroma is warm and ambrosial. I have been left in awe. I was reminded not only that I am loved, but of how deep and wide his love lives for me. Every fiber of my being felt jolted and rejuvenated at the same time. I am his daughter, and he is my father, my Abba, my Lord.
Mm-hmm.
1 John 4, 7 says, "Beloved, let us love one another, for love is from God, and whoever loves has been born of God and knows God." Verse 9 through 11 says, "In this, the love of God was made manifest among us, that God sent his only Son into the world so that we might live through him. In this is love, not that we have loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation of our sins." God, you make me laugh. I realize that since I have come to know you, you showed me and you told me that you made the most humble sacrifice. You sent your only Son to crucifixion so that I can live. I acknowledged this intellectually. I said, "I got it, that's cool. You know, I'm blessed, I get it." But here's the kick. It was not until this moment, which was earlier this week, that I realized how much that sacrifice represents. Have you ever had something in your face and you're looking at it clear as day, but you still don't see it? You're funny, God. Thank you for taking the time to laugh with me about my airheadedness. I have a deeper level of appreciation for you now. Thank you for opening my eyes. Thank you for showing me how significant I am. I am greater than anything I could fathom, and you believing me because you love me. First John 4:11 says, Beloved, if God so loves us, we also ought to love one another. So we have come to know and to believe the love that God has for us. God is love, and whoever abides in love abides in God, and God abides in him. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear. For fear has to do with punishment, and whoever fears has not been perfected in love. We love because he first loved us. At this time, I was like, whew, you know, like I did that, you know, and I thought, I am blown away. What? What, God? You mean this whole time you love me and I love you and I pursue you and you reside in me so that I can love on others and show them who you are because I'm loved? What? It was amazing. So my application has become a proclamation. Whenever I forget who I am, all I have to do is ask you to remind me. You will show me that I am truly loved and that I am worthy. Excuse me. I am victorious over my fears because you have lit the path of unconditional love and I receive it. Your love, excuse me. Your love is deeper than the deepest parts of the ocean and even more intimate than anything my flesh could understand. I choose to surrender to your will for my life. I relinquish every fear to your feet. I will see the good in me as you do, and I will embrace you. I will embrace who I am because you made me. I will see comfort in you. My prayer, Lord, you are my Savior, almighty creator and protector. I praise you. Jesus, I ask that you give me the strength to be still so that I may surrender to your will. Let me be still so that I could be filled with your goodness. Let your sweet fragrance continue to fill me. I pray for more of you, for you are love and I need love. Let your tenderness be transparent in me so that I may love myself as much as I can love others. Flood me. Give me more of you. Surround me with your glory and grace. You have conquered my heart with the spirit of truth. I cannot ask for more. Thank you, Heavenly Father. I carry you in my heart so that you can be my anchor, and I pray that I learn from your example of what a true sacrifice looks like. Amen.
Amen. Wow, good stuff. Anybody else? Hasn't this been good? Hi, Bill.
Good morning, everybody. I have a special scripture today. Hebrews 12th chapter, 2nd verse. Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. In Hebrews 13, the 6th verse and the 8th verse, we can say then that the Lord is our hope, and we can say with confidence that the Lord is our hope. I will not be afraid. What can man do to me? Jesus Christ is the same yesterday and today and forever. Amen. When I came to the time in my life where I was actually retiring, everything had been so beautiful in my life, and I'd been with the Lord all the way through. I looked to him every day, and all of a sudden the devil came to roost, and they proved to have lies about me, and they were ready to send me to jail. They sent the lies that I had committed a crime to the prosecuting attorneys. They had sent it to the police, and it looked like I was really in for a lot of trouble. And I turned my eyes to Jesus again, and I cried out, Lord, help me. These people are lying about me. I did not do any of those things. And the Lord started to work upon my behalf. First of all, one of the students of mine had a wonderful father who was a top-flight lawyer. And she said to this father of hers, Mr. Elder could not have done any of that. Be his lawyer. And of course, the lawyer wanted a high price. The court wanted a lot of money. And so I went to the bank, and I asked the loan officer if I could borrow $5,000 to do the things that the court and this lawyer wanted to do. And the bank loan said, no, we don't give money for that kind of thing. But the president of the bank heard about it, and he said, give Mr. Elder that money. We don't worry about what he's going to use it for. And so the Lord came to my right hand again and gave the money. The lawyer said to me, the local police will want to give you a lie detector test. You go ahead and take it. Pay for it. Let the local police do their thing. If you did not do the crime, you have no worries. So I went ahead and they interviewed me. They gave me the first lie detector test. Then they decided they'd interview me again, the second lie detector test. At the end of 4 hours, they decided to give me the third lie detector test and the third interview. Finally, the man who was giving all these tests wrote out a nice little statement. Mr. Elder passed all lie detector tests. He has not done any of these crimes. He is now free of any further law and situation. Oh, what a wonderful thing. Then, all of a sudden, the People First of Washington and the Washington State Protective and Advocacy System heard about my situation. They hired me to become an investigator and investigate the people that had made the lies about me. Wow! See what the Lord can do? He was on all sides and made sure that I was able to come through. And I do every day look to the Lord. I wake up. I look upon the face of the Lord, a nice picture that I have in my books, and I just praise Him every day. For He's been with me all my life.
Thank you, Bill.
Yes.
Awesome, my friend.
I tell you, He is a great Lord.
Yes, He is.
God is your protector. He's your rear guard. Hallelujah. Well, I'm just going to share just a really short soap with you. It's actually this morning. It's that fresh and that rough. But I was reading in Deuteronomy chapter 1, verse 8. And the verse is, let me just read it to you. See, I've set the land before you. Go in and take possession of the land that the Lord swore to your fathers, to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob, to give to them and to their offspring after them. And, you know, as I was looking at that, you know, I thought, well, is there a command here? Yeah, there's a command to behold the land. The land speaks of our inheritance. It speaks of the promises of God. There's a command to first see, to observe, to get a revelation of it. And then the next command is to rise and begin to take possession of it. And the promise from that passage is, I'm the one that has set the land before you. I'm the one that has empowered you and equipped you to do what I'm calling you to do. And
what's the scripture?
Deuteronomy chapter 1, verse 8. The application, this is what I put. Take the time to see what God has said. Take the time to look at the inheritance, the rich inheritance that He has given us. Let your imagination go with it and see yourself in possession of it. This will position you to receive the strategy to take possession. But see, you have to see it. It's really hard to take possession of something you can't see. It's really hard to know how to get there or to receive God's strategy until you see what God is saying, until you see the promise. Do not be afraid, for God is with you. And see, it would be easy to see they're looking at the land, it would be easy for them to just kind of see all the obstacles in the way. You know, there's giants in the land. There's fortified cities. That, you know, just because God gives you something doesn't mean it's going to just be smooth.
Amen.
Yeah. When God shows you something, there often is obstacles there. But see, He's with you.
Amen.
He's with you to take that land, to step into your inheritance.
Yes.
And so my prayer was, Father, thank you for your rich inheritance. Help me to see it clearly. Show me your strategy for taking possession of it. I receive the promise and embrace the power that comes with it to take possession of everything that you've given me.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord. Wow, it's afternoon. Normally I'd call the worship team up. I think we'll not do that today. Why don't we stand together? How many have been ministered to by some of the things that you've heard today? You know, I love that the theme of love. That can never get old with us. You know, but here's something that I discovered, and this might irk some of you, I don't know. But here's what I discovered. That when the guy came to Jesus and said, "What is the greatest commandment in the law?" Now he's talking about the law. He's talking about Old Covenant. He said, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. And then a second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself." Do you know that's Old Covenant? Well, wait a minute, Pastor Dave. Don't say that. But see, Jesus said, "This is my commandment, that you love one another." In fact, the way God measures our love for Him is how we love one another. Remember, John said, if someone says they love God but they don't love their brother, they're lying.
Amen.
Whoa.
Pretty blunt.
It is pretty blunt. The way I express my love for God, or let me say it this way, one of the ways that I express my love for God is by letting His love overpower me in such a way that I can't help but express it to my brothers and sisters. So, Father, we just thank you for all that you said today, for all the things that you stirred in our hearts. Lord, you're doing an amazing thing. And, Lord, we receive it all. We want it all in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you, saints. Have a wonderful week. Go in God's love, God's peace, and dream.